Hello and welcome back. We are at module 7. And in this module, we will use the same model that I used in the previous examples, but this time I will concentrate on doing the actual visualizations, adding pivot charts, adding slicers, connecting both, go a little more into cube functions, which I mentioned, but I didn't show you the details. We were using them. So I'm going to use those also. So using the actual model for creating the visualization. So we are starting with Excel. We have one of the examples I had before, but actually I'm not going to touch it. I'm going to open a new worksheet here and start adding stuff to it and building on the model which is already here. So first I would like to build some kind of a dashboard. So that would probably will be built off pivot charts. Now, a pivot chart can be standalone. This is not new for 2016, but it just was added in the previous version of Excel. The fact that you can add a pivot chart without adding the pivot table first. So I can use the pivot chart, insert pivot chart. The default, again, is to use the work with data model. So I'm happy with the default. And I click OK. So I got this chart. It's pretty big, so maybe because I want to show a few of them, I'll make it smaller. One good thing is actually, before we continue, it's always a good idea in creating this kind of visualizations to turn off a few Excel features like grid lines, the most important one. We really don't need the grid lines as we're not doing any, almost any Excel references and so on. So here's the pivot chart, and the pivot chart has the field list. Now I cleaned the field list by hiding some tables in, for example, you don't see here the main sales table. Actually you see it only as the measures in it, and it shows as this sales with a sigma and prawn. So once you, what I did, I have hidden all the columns, and I'm left only with the measures. So this is the way it actually looks, and it's much easier to work. And I'm trying to, when I'm giving this to a person to build their own visualizations, I'm trying to minimize the amount of things that they will see. If they don't need all the tables, I will hide some of the tables. If they don't need columns, I will hide those and so on. So I can start selecting. Let's say it's, I want to see our sales, and I want to see them by segment. So here it is, most of our sales are just in a few segments. And let's build another one, another pivot chart. I have to go out of the existing one. Oop. Here, insert pivot chart, once again, okay. Again, make it a little smaller and put it somewhere here, maybe making it the same size. And maybe now I want to see something else. I want to see the revenue for all and not just for our sales. And this time I want to break it by the manufacturers. Actually, I added the manufacturers to the product table, and so I can choose it from here. So now we have the, so I'm not really concerned now about making it really nice looking and playing with all the properties and the design. You can go and select styles, and I like personally the black one, but you might like something else. There's a lot of options to make this prettier, but I want to concentrate more on the functionality. Now, probably what I want is also to add a bunch of slicers so that the person who is using this dashboard can actually control it and slice on different things. So I can go again to the field list, and let's say I want a slicer by year. So I'm opening the calendar. In the calendar, I have some hierarchy that I will explain in a moment what it is, but for the moment, I will just pick from the other fields which are not part of the hierarchy. I will pick the year and add it as a slicer. So here it is as a slicer. You see that the calendar table has more years in it than actually there's data. So there's data only from 2011 to 2015. the calendar. So the years which don't have any data are shown here in the bottom. I can also make them disappear if I want to. So now when I click on it, it does affect the chart, but it affects only one chart and not the other. The reason is that I started this slicer from the context of this specific chart. If I want to make this slicer connect to the other chart, I will have to go either through the options for the slicer, go to report connections, and check the other chart, which is in my worksheet, which is currently named sheet 3. It's actually a good idea to go and name the charts and the pivot and give them meaningful names, so it will be easier to know what slicer connects to which pivot or pivot table or pivot chart. Now that I did that, and when I click on years, you probably notice that both charts respond to my clicking on the slicer. And I might have more slicers, and some of the slicers might affect all pivot charts, and some of the slicers might affect just a subset of the pivot charts. Slicers can be also connected to elements like pivot charts and pivot tables, which actually reside even on other worksheets, not necessarily this one. So it could be a whole network of elements like pivot tables, pivot charts, and slicers in different worksheets. I mentioned before hierarchies. Let's take a look at that. In order to see the definition of a hierarchy and explain a little bit what it is, I will go and look at the manage window and switch to the diagram view. If you remember, the diagram view is a view in which I see the relationships between the tables and I see all the tables. And also it's the location in which I can actually see or define new hierarchies. So for example, the calendar table that I created through the automatic tool in Power Pivot already have a hierarchy named date hierarchy. So the hierarchy is a collection of fields. Here it's year, month, and date that they actually naturally go together. So you go and you drill from year to month to date. So if you define those three together, then when you move them to the pivot, they go together. And then it's easy to go and start by clicking on the plus sign, drilling from year to month, from month to date, and so on. And as you saw before, we also have drilling experience on the pivot charts. You can create your own hierarchies. Sometimes they are natural, like here. I also have on the locations table, I have a hierarchy called geo, which is country, state, and city. In theory, I can actually create any arbitrary hierarchy and not just those natural ones, which are like geographic one and the time, because there's an advantage. If there's a specific way to drill, a drill path that is repeating itself, it may be a good idea to add it as a hierarchy to one of the tables. Let's go back to Excel. And now I want to explain a little bit about the other option to show and to visualize data, which is not pivot tables and not pivot charts. And those are the cube functions. So if you've seen before someone showing cube functions, probably what they did is this way. They created a pivot table. So let me create a new pivot table right in the bottom here. And let me choose a measure, maybe this, and something on, let's say, drag the geo hierarchy. So you notice when I drag the geo to hierarchy, I actually can now immediately start drilling from countries to state and to cities. And okay, I have this. Now let's have something on filter. Or actually, you know what? Let's connect this pivot to the existing slicer by year. To do that, I can go either to the options, as I showed before, of the slicer and connect it to the new pivot. I can also go to the pivot, and from the special UI for the pivot, I can go to something called filter connections and say that I want to connect this pivot to a slicer called year. That I have a few of them because I have also others in other worksheets, but This one is the one that I'm looking at in the sheet three. When I click OK, now the pivot is connected also to this. So once I have this pivot, I can actually go and again from the analyze area in the ribbon, I can go to somewhere called OLAP tools, and I can use something called convert to formulas. When I did that, actually the area in which the pivot used to be looks almost the same, only that actually I lost the drilling capability, but every one of the cells is now actually, as you see in the formula bar, it is a formula. It's not, there's no pivot anymore. And the formula is using each one of the cells use here one of the cube functions. There are seven of them, and now I will show you, so I was able to convert the pivot into a bunch of formulas. Notice that the formulas still are calculated when I click on the slicer. So they actually reference the slicer, and I can continue to control them with the slicer. Now there are seven cube functions. I don't have really the time to go into detail, and I will provide some reference to material that you can learn more about the cube functions. But let me do just a simple example. So one of the functions that is not used in the automatic conversion is this one, the cube set. And I can now, when you use the cube functions, the first argument is always the connection name. And you can just double click on the double quote, and it will come, and you complete it with tab, double quote again. And now another double quote, and it lists the elements in the model. And now I can say, for example, that I want to go to the product dimension, and I want to get manufacturer and all manufacturers. And now actually I'm writing something that is not as, I added something manually, which is the function dot children. This function is actually an MDX function. MDX is the language that we use to connect to OLAP cubes. Those functions were created back in 2007 to be used exclusively with OLAP cubes. It's another technology that, it's a predecessor of the model technology that we saw in Excel, but now we can actually reuse it against the model that we have in Excel. So if you want to do a little bit of more advanced stuff and not just convert pivot tables to functions, you have to know a little bit of this MDX language. So now I can give it a name, and I can call it manufacturers. And now once I have this, actually in this set, I have cell, I have the list of all manufacturers. And with another function, I can start calling the members there one by one. So I can refer to this cell, and absolutely, and then say, give me member number one. And now I can copy it over and say, now I want member number two from the set. And once I have them, I can start doing, let me just complete the example by adding a cube member function, which is just bringing a specific member, either a measure or from any other area in the model. In this case, I want to measure. I want to say that the measure is our sales. And here I can use a function called cube value that is actually will be using this member here, not only this one. So it will use the name of the manufacturer, and there's a variable number of parameters. So it will use also this element, and it will actually use it this way. And it will also use the slicer, which is slicer year underscore one. So once I'm done, there's no data for this one. But in this way, I can refer to different elements, and by doing this, I can build, and this is similar to the ones which are generated automatically, but now I can make it any shape or form that I want, and this is the main advantage of this thing. I can always do something like cut and paste them somewhere else, which is something that I would not be able to do if this was a pivot. This is possible only because those are function and they are easy to move around, and I can start building my reports. And if you remember, when you open the material, you will see an example called Freestyle that is using those very extensively. So we saw the few options for visualizations. So we saw how to create a few pivot charts, connect them to one or more slicers. And we also saw some of the basics of creating cube functions, either by converting a pivot into functions or formulas, or by doing manual creation of formulas. Thank you, and see you on the next module.